Well, thank you very much, Chairperson Randall. It is an honor for me to be here this afternoon. First of all, yes, good afternoon, everybody. Okay, I'm going to try that again. I think the whole half of the audience here, and maybe one row in the front, did not respond, so I know they're probably asleep. Let me just ask. Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
All right, certainly heard the young people up here. It's a tremendous honor for me to participate in this fourth annual salute to the military, to the military families, and to veterans. I was asked earlier this year if I would be willing to do this, and I said, obviously, yes. I get a chance to give speeches and to talk all around the country from a wide variety of different organizations, and to me, this is something that's a pleasure for me. It's always an honor to me, and particularly when it's an organization sponsored by the American Legion. I am a member of the American Legion, and I've been involved in Legion activities all over the country. Even though I don't live in Lyle County, my son, my daughter-in-law, my two grandkids do live. They live in the Potomac Falls area. My son, Philip, is over on the side there. So your hand raised up for Potomac Falls. Shout out to Potomac Falls. I actually live in Fairfax County. I live in Vienna, Virginia. And some people think because I'm the chairman of the board of USAA that I live in San Antonio, Texas. The answer is no. But thank God for executive jets. I go down there about two or three times a month and spend a lot of time in San Antonio as chair of that great, large organization that, by the way, now ranks number 102 on the Fortune 500 list because of the clout and size we have of USAA. And I'll talk about USAA very briefly in association with veterans and things we're doing for veterans in my remarks. Now, I'm going to keep my remarks relatively short, primarily because I know most of you are actually here to hear this wonderful violin and choir behind me and the choir up front there. So I don't want to delay any of that at all, so I know you're really here to hear them. I said orchestra, I think that's your name. I mean, you're from a different high school than this one here. So you'll get to hear them a little bit later. So I'll keep my remarks relatively short, but I told Phyllis Randall to not worry about how to introduce me. To be honest with you, my bio is very long, and it's all because I'm an old person. And once you're an old person, you have a lot of things in your resume more than anything else. Probably none of them are significant to most people, but it is a rather long list. And what I did not suggest to her aide, who asked how should I be introduced, my call sign, when I've had a chance to fly for the Air Force, is Dude. My son, my daughters, and even my wife call me by my nickname and my call sign, Dude. And so if she just said, here's Dude, I would have responded, fellas, I would have come right up to the microphone. I'm also very, very proud to see at least one member veteran here in uniform. His name is Dick Graff. Dick, can you stand, please, so we all can recognize you, a World War II veteran. Now, I told somebody earlier that I usually wear my uniform. I retired, as Phyllis mentioned, in 2003, but I usually wear my uniform on every occasion I have an opportunity to do so. Whether it's promotion ceremonies, retirement ceremonies, or events like this, particularly four-star generals are allowed to put their uniforms back on for those occasions. And I do usually wear my uniform, so I regret now with seeing Dick's uniform that I did not wear mine. I will tell you, Dick, even though I retired in 2003, my uniform still fits. Is that your original uniform?
Not this way.
Okay.
we got a little problem right here.
Okay. Believe me, you don't have a problem at all. You don't have a problem at all. We're honored to see you in that great uniform. The last time I wore my uniform was retired Air Force two-star who has worked for me for years. I retired at the Pentagon just a couple of months ago. And yes, it does still fit, thank God. My background, just very, very briefly before I talk a little bit about vets and the importance of vets, is I'm a native of this area. I'm a native of Washington, D.C. Born and raised in Washington, D.C., I went to McKinley Technical High School. And coming out of high school, I turned down an opportunity to go to the Air Force Academy and decided to stay local and went to Howard University, the historical black college, the School of Engineering at Howard. I am an engineer, and I was part of Air Force ROTC at Howard University. A lot of people, perhaps not the young people in the audience, but those who are a little bit up in age know that land-grant universities like Maryland, Howard, etc., ROTC was mandatory. You had to do it your first 2 years of college. And then if you wanted to stay in ROTC or you had scholarships or something like that, you then completed the last 2 years and eventually got a commission. And that's what I did. And I planned to spend literally just 4 years as an engineer in the United States Air Force. That 4 years somehow ended up being 35 and a half years. And I served very, very proudly and had a wonderful, wonderful career as part of that, doing lots of exciting things, mostly in the science and technology, engineering, logistics world. I ended up being the 27th Vice Chief of Staff, the number two person in the Air Force in charge in the Pentagon for a couple of years. And then I served my last four-star tour as the commander of our Air Force Material Command, a big research and development organization at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, but with bases all over the country. 82,000 people worked for me, and we had an annual budget of about $46 billion a year that we were responsible for as part of the United States Air Force. Now, I probably would have continued to serve. By law and Congress, four stars particularly can serve up to 40 years. I got out at 35, but in part I got out because of a message, what sort of message I got from my grandson. My grandson, Justin, my son's son, when he was very young, about 5 years old, on Martin Luther King's celebration, Martin Luther King's birthday, my son took Justin downtown D.C. and they were part of the celebrations there. And my son mentioned to my grandson, he said, you know, your grandfather was actually there when Martin Luther King did his famous march, March of Freedom in Washington, D.C. And he was part of that activity. And for those of you who are counting, the answer is yes, that's true. I was a young, just out of high school, 16-year-old, just turned 17, a freshman at Howard University. And I was part of the March of Freedom down there for Martin Luther King. I will tell you, I was not there for any social conscious reason. I was a 17-year-old, and like a typical 17-year-old, I was down there because I knew there would be girls down there. And so my reason for there had nothing to do with Martin Luther King whatsoever, but it was a human thing. I think everybody can understand that. So I was very proud that my son, my grandson, called me up at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base that night. He was very proud to call and say, you know, Grandpa, we celebrated, went down and participated in the celebration of Martin Luther King Day, and I was very, very pleased, this is him speaking, to hear that you were there. You were there when Martin Luther King had his March of Freedom on the 29th of August in 1963. And I said, yes. And I was proud that my grandson recognized that. And then in his next breath, he said, and Grandpa, we've been studying about Martin Luther King in school. We've also been studying about Ben Franklin. Were you there when Ben Franklin threw his kite? And for those of you who are senior in the audience, when your grandchildren think that you're from the colonial days, you know it's time to retire. And I literally put in my papers the next day and I retired later that year. I mentioned that I live in Fairfax County, but I do get out to Loudoun County a lot. Very, very proud just to see the growth in this community. Literally close to 400,000 people, the richest, if not the most prosperous county in the United States in terms of per capita income. You have great leadership here, great leadership in the Congress. Speaking of a small world category, I've never met Congresswoman Barbara Comstock, but just ironically, my grandson, Justin, the one who kicked me out of the Air Force, my grandson, Justin, girlfriend, Caitlin, served on her staff as an intern this past summer, so I heard a lot of great things about her. And Loudoun County itself is just a wonderful, wonderful place to be. You might know, since I'm born and raised in Washington, D.C., I have stamped on my birth certificate, diehard racing fan. So that's... good if I said something about that D team that's playing tomorrow. Probably gets my hands there too. But I'm not going to mention it. I'm not going to mention that at all. I even get my hair cut at Sharp Lines Cut Barbershop here in Ashburn. So Ashburn and Loudoun County, all of this area, Sterling, every Leesburg, all have become very, very familiar to me and the things that we do. And I've been blessed to have a lot of things that I get a chance to participate in since I retired. I tell people I'm flunking retirement because I serve on several corporate boards. I do pro bono things in the White House, State Department. I chair NASA's Advisory Council. I'm a member of the National Academy of Engineers, and I do things for them. But probably the proudest thing that I'm involved in is USAA. Let me just see a show of hands or clapping. How many of you out there are USAA members? Quite a few. Well, I hope we're serving you well. I'm very proud of that organization, but the thing I'm most proud of is the things we do for veterans. We really believe, as our motto says, we know what it means to serve. And when we talk about that, it really is important to us to know what the lives are of the military members, the military families, but particularly the veterans and the things that they're going through, things they have gone through, and the things they will go through in the future. I will tell you, as part of our belief in supporting veterans, 25% of our 33,000 employees of USAA around the country are veterans or spouses of veterans. Our goal is actually to exceed 30%, and we will actually do that this year. Since 2007, we've brought in veterans alone, not counting the spouses, some 12,000 new employees who are veterans, and we believe in everything that we do in supporting them. And why is that important to us? I'm saying something that I know all of you as veterans out there know and understand. But for any company, any organization that may not recognize this, vets understand and believe in strong work ethic. They believe in team building and team building skills. The core values of integrity and ethics, they're action oriented and they're mission focused. And those are the kinds of people we need in our workforce. They're the kind of people we need in our communities. They're the kinds of leaders we need in Congress and in all the things that are important to this great United States of ours. So what do we do to make sure that we're supporting veterans, not just hiring them? I'll just mention a couple of programs that we have for veterans. We have one we call Combat to Claims, where we actually train new veterans who just left the services. We train them in a very, very quick, accelerated, but excellent program to be claims officers for insurance purposes in the things that we do at USAA. I have the honor every time I go down to USAA or to San Antonio or to any one of our campuses around the country to spend time with those who are part of that program. One, to show them that I'm a vet, but also to listen and to talk to them about the opportunities that they have to continue to serve. We have a program we call Vet Fit, with the emphasis on the IT in the fit part. It's a 22-week coder program to literally train IT professionals who are coming out of the services to do all the IT work that is so endemic and important to almost any organization today. We have a program we call Vet Lead, where we are training the leaders of our corporation for the future, taking those NCOs and seniors and officers who are coming out of the military, who've come into USAA, and putting them in key positions, accelerated positions, so they can be the executive leaders of USAA in the very, very near future. And as part of our corporate social responsibility, we believe in focusing on military family resiliency. Phyllis Randall mentioned that, the resiliency of military families. And so everywhere we have a campus around the country, we're doing things we can to support the families and their needs in those military communities. And probably one of the things as an example that I'm most proud of recently, about 2 years ago, we partnered with the mayor of San Antonio to end homelessness of veterans in the city of San Antonio. It turns out most of the homeless in San Antonio were veterans. And actually, if you go around to any community, any large community, particularly where there is a military presence, and you actually look at and check on some of the homeless, you'll find that a lot of them are veterans. We donated about $4 million working with the city of San Antonio with the vow to get the veteran homeless off the streets. And I'm proud to tell you that. That was 3 years ago we started the program. I'm proud to tell you that today, there's not a homeless veteran in the city of San Antonio. Now, there are some who opted not to allow us to support them. And so I'm not saying you will not find a homeless person who wasn't a veteran, but anyone who wanted to be helped, we helped them. We got them off the street, we got them into homes, we got them into jobs. Most of those jobs are actually at U.S. veterans. That program has been so successful in San Antonio, wherever we have a campus, in Phoenix, in Tampa, in Chesapeake. We're taking that program, Colorado Springs also. We're expanding that program to do the same thing in those big cities. Well, I said I wanted to keep my remarks really brief. Let me just close by talking about advice that I give to communities when it comes to veterans and supporting the military. And I'll start with the vets and then I'll end with the families, if you will. For the vets, you know, it's obvious, you hear this all the time. Thank those in uniform, particularly. When you get a chance to see and to talk to them, somebody, just thank them. Thank them for their service. Thank them for what they're doing. But the same also applies to veterans. When you find a veteran, thank them. But also thank the family members, because they also provide a tremendous sacrifice to help the veterans to do what they do every day. I used to tell people, and matter of fact, I said this when I retired, the old Ben Miller song, Wind Beneath My Wings, and I described that along with describing and thanking my wife for my 35 years in the United States Air Force. And then as I thought about it, as I was making my remarks, I realized that wasn't sufficient. She wasn't just the wind beneath the wings. She was the wings, the engines, and often the pilot. Of everything that our family accomplished, because she was the one leading the way when I was away doing things for the Air Force. And I dare say that applies to the family members of any veteran, any military person who's out there in the audience or anywhere within this country. Certainly, hire vets when you have an opportunity, but also don't ignore the spouses. Hire veteran spouses when you have an opportunity. And something I did very successfully when I was on uniform, some of the companies out there, or maybe partnered with other companies and organizations, may declare a year of the military family and look for ways that you can do things together to support the needs of the military family. It could be any number of things that you can do, but look for ways and seek ways that you can support them. And when I give advice, I also like to give advice to military members themselves, including the veterans. And the main advice to them, tell your story. It is amazing today how few people can recognize or identify with the military or military service. I think Rob stated earlier, there are only about 7% of our population of people who've actually served. In Congress today, I don't know the exact number, Congresswoman Comstock, but the number is roughly about 20% of the members of Congress who've actually served. Back in 1971, by the way, that was 73%. And so it's important for people to really understand what it's like to serve in the military, to be a military family member, or to be a military vet. And one of the ways to have that happen is for you, the vets and military members, to tell your stories. Don't be shy about explaining both the challenges, but also the opportunities as a result of your having served. So let me close by saying the word service. You know, when I look out at the service members, family members, the veterans particularly, but also I look at these young people in front of me and the young people behind me. They're the leaders. You're the leaders of today. Some of you are the leaders of the past, but they are the leaders of the future. And I'm also reminded of a question that was asked of a Southern minister one day by one of his parishioners, who was very impressed that this minister had a very robust church, and people really enjoyed being part of that church. And he served them very, very well. And he was a good leader. And he was asked by this parishioner, please, could you tell me, minister, what does it take to be a good leader? And the answer is a very simple one. The answer was, to be a good leader, first you have to know how to serve. And I think that applies to our men and women in uniform, those in the past, those today, and certainly those in the future. And I think that no better way to prepare to be a leader than to serve this great country of ours, to serve our communities, and to serve our flag. Thank you very much for inviting me. I salute all of you, and God bless you.